You are so lucky right now, because while the judges are away for an indeterminate amount of time, you get to be entertained by the wonderful Kyle Evans, who was last year's FameLab winner. He not only won this, the Oxford final, he went on to win the national final. Kyle is a folk singer, a comedian, and a maths teacher. He's performed at Cheltenham Science Festival, Blissfield's Blue Dot. He's been on Radio 4's more or less. It seems everyone's been on Radio 4. His speciality is that he can do the alphabet backwards. But his main thing that he likes to do is singing about maths. And he is very proud that his song about the Riemann hypothesis, a mathematical hypothesis, I don't know why I'm telling you, you all know what the Riemann hypothesis is, right? Yeah. His song about the Riemann hypothesis was used as a local radio jingle, which was probably the first time that has ever happened. When he's not singing, he's doing maths, and when he's not doing maths, he's singing. Luckily for you, he's going to be doing both. Welcome to the stage, Kyle Evans.
Hello. It's lovely to be back. There it is. This is the bit in the evening, a bit like X Factor or Strictly, where they get last year's winner back, and you go, really? It's a slow year. It's lovely to be here. I've proven I can do it for 3 minutes, so this is my chance to prove that I can go on a bit longer. Insert your own punchline there. I've been writing science-based songs for the last year or so, and it's quite hard writing science songs because you've got to be factually correct, and you've also got to try and be entertaining. And there'll always be someone to whom your song is not factually correct enough, and there'll be someone to whom your song is not entertaining enough. And generally, as long as it's not the same person, then you're doing okay. But I say that, but even over the course of the last year, the climate has changed somewhat, hasn't it? And that whole bit about being factually correct, kind of not so important anymore. So there are some benefits to living in 2017. I used to have to really like fact-check all the scientific bits of my songs, and now I just think, oh, I just ride it on the train on the way to the gig. And if any of it's not right, it's kind of win-win, because then I get to troll some of the proper scientists in the audience as well. I don't really know that much about science, so I decided I'd write a song based on all the bits of science I could remember from school. And because it's 2017, I just wouldn't bother to fact-check it, and we see how we go. So let's go for it. Oxygen goes in your mouth, CO2 comes out. Somewhere at the other end, methane hangs about. Oh, chemistry is really cool, chemistry's the best, especially if you come from Albuquerque dealing crystal meth. Don't worry about it, Evie, don't worry about it, Jed. If you can't keep that pesky 8x table in your head. When you're older, you'll have a computer in your brain, so don't stress yourself about it, go watch Ice Age 4 again. Biology is great, it's science without all the graphs. Strut those peacock feathers, boys, no you don't look daft. And pass that gene for confidence onto your next of kin. They'll end up in parliament where confidence alone is king. Archaeology is wonderful, it really is profound. God tested our faith by hiding dinos underground. biology is different, I don't remember why, but that geek and friends got laid, so maybe I'll give it a try. Applied math. Newton said things zoom around until they stop and crash. And Einstein said don't move too fast or time will bend and break. So if you go fast asleep, you could be younger when you wake. Ooh, alternative facts of science. Come on, your turn, here we go. Thank you very much. I'm kidding, really, to an extent. I do know a little bit more about science than that. But it's kind of an awkward song to do that, because in gigs not like tonight, where people aren't polite and stay put, if they kind of wander in during the song, they just think you're a complete idiot. A guy came up to me at the end of a gig. He said, you can't describe Newton's laws of motion that way. That's really irresponsible. You must stop doing that song. I kind of thought it was quite sweet, really. His heart was in the right place, at least, because you need to be a bit pedantic sometimes. You know, sometimes in life, you've got to point out other people's mistakes. You know that phrase, a hair's breadth, meaning a small margin, like the width of one hair, a hair's breadth. You know that phrase? Well, my whole life up until this year, I've been saying a hair's breath. So I thought it was like the exhalation of a large rabbit, a hair's breath. And I really wish someone at any point over the last 20 or so years had just said, what are you saying? That's mental. A hair is not even a particularly small animal. That's a large rabbit. Why would it be a hair's breadth? But it's okay, you know, the point is it's all right to be pedantic as long as you go up to the point. I mean, it's ironic that I was making that mistake, because one of the things that I do a lot is correct people when they constantly say the proof is in the pudding. So that the phrase actually is the proof of the pudding is in the eating, you know, and it seems to be socially acceptable to do that. And generally, they're like, oh, yeah, fair dues. But, you know, if you write a letter to the BBC in sort of ransom style newspaper cutouts, threatening Greg Wallace that if he keeps saying the proof is in the pudding, you're going to track down and hurt one of his many wives or illegitimate children, that doesn't, I mean, so I hear, that doesn't go down so well. So I think pedantry is okay, just as long as you understand where the line is, you know. So this song's for any pedants in the audience. He's a pedant. He knows that strawberry's not a fruit. He's a pedant. He knows Brazil nuts aren't nuts too. He's a pedant. And each time that he walks into a room, everybody gets self-conscious whether they meant who or whom. He's a pedant. He thinks that snooker's not a sport. He's a pedant. He knows Napoleon wasn't short. He's a pedant. When he watches QI, he just gets sour, 'cause he knew it all already. Now he's wasted half an hour. And he says things like, I hate to tell you this, but I'll let you down gently. Kirk never said beam me up, Sherlock never said elementary, and Ingrid Bergman never said play it again, Sam. And you'll be thinking, frankly, mate, I couldn't give a damn. He's a pedant. Don't say you're starving when he's near. He's a pedant. He'll say, you mean hungry, my dear. He's a pedant. Don't talk to him, you know what to expect. He'll be oh so condescending if your chromosome's XX. And recently he got a text from an old flame's number. It woke him from an uncharacteristically deep slumber. Said, "You're going to be a daddy." He was shocked beyond belief, 'cause they'd misspelt your Y-O-U-R, not Y-O-U-R-E. Y-O-U apostrophe R-E, of course, I should say. He's a pedant. He knows the capital of Chad. He's a pedant. It's N'Djamena, but then you knew that. He's a pedant. And the strangest thing you'd have to say, he writes songs in the third person just to make it seem okay. He writes songs in the third person just to make it seem okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. So, since I was last here, I have actually written an hour-long folk mathematics set, because that's what the world was really crying out for, was another hour of folk music-based mathematics material. And a large part of that set is about songs that I'm so pedantic that I have to pull apart and sort of question the mathematics in. And one of these songs is by Paul Simon, called 50 Ways to Leave Your Lover. Do you know that song by Paul Simon, 50 Ways to Leave Your Lover? What I mean, when I first found out there was a song called 50 Ways to Leave Your Lover, I was like, oh, this is going to be amazing. It's going to be about 8 minutes long, sort of rambling Dylan-esque tirade. And frankly, I was disappointed when I listened to the song. It's kind of like, "The problem's all inside your head," she said to me. "It could be easy if you take it logically. I'm here to help you with your struggle to be free. There must be 50 ways to leave your lover." And then he just kind of keeps rambling on and on and on and on, when what you really want him to do is get to the 50 ways to leave your lover part of the song. But still, he just keeps going constantly, and you think, surely it can't be long until we get to the part about 50 ways to leave your lover. Just repeat that line for good measure. 50 ways to leave your lover. Just slip out the back, Jack. Make a new plan, Stan. No need to be coy, Roy. Get yourself free. Hop on the bus, Gus. Don't need to discuss much. Just drop off the key, Lee. Get yourself free. And that's it. That's all the ways to leave your lover that he describes in the song. I mean, it's an 8-line chorus. One of the lines is repeated, so we'll call that, you know, 7 ways to leave your lover, which is like 14% of the promised ways to leave your lover. I think Paul Simon should definitely have to, you know, face advertising standards or something for that. It does go on. There's another verse, a couple of verses, another chorus. The chorus is just repeated. So that's as many ways to leave your lover as you're going to get from this song. And I was very disappointed when I found this to be the case. So you can probably guess what's going to come next. I decided I would finish off the song that Paul was so lazy about in the 70s. I'll give him those 7, but that doesn't mean we need 43 more ways to leave your lover. 43 more ways to leave your lover. Just get on your bike, Mike. Get off the scene, Dean. Get out of there quick, Nick. Get yourself free. Knock it on the head, Ed. Take it on the chin, Flynn. Keep it short and sweet, Pete. Get yourself free. Time to get gone, Ron. Time to be flying, Ryan. Time to be fleeing, Ian. Get yourself free. I think you best go, Joe. I think you best fly, Guy. It's time that you ran, Dad. Get yourself free. So that was like 4 choruses with 3 in each, which is 12 more ways to leave your lover. 12 off of 43 is 31 to go. But I know what you're thinking, ladies. It's International Women's Day, right? And all of this song's kind of sexist, so all about ways that men could leave women. So I thought for the next batch we'd have some ways that women could leave men instead. So 31 more ways to leave your lover. 31 more ways to leave your lover. Just jump in a cab, Babs. Jump in a taxi, Maxi. Get on a plane, Jane. Get yourself free. Step out the gate, Kate. Time to get gone, Dawn. Jump out the window, Linda. Get yourself free. It's no dilemma, Emma. This'll come in handy, Mandy. Get a new agenda, Brenda. Get yourself free. Find a new place, Trace. Find a new palace, Alice. Find a new thrill, Jill. Get yourself free. No need to stress test. No one last kiss, Fliss. No final quickie, Nikki. Get yourself free. Get out of there, Claire. Don't scrape the barrel, Carol. I won't say it again, Elaine. Get yourself free. So that was six choruses that time. Six threes is 18 off of 31. Is 13, I believe. I'm no mathematician. But I know what you're thinking. 13 is not divisible by 3, is it? 13 is 1 mod 3, which means I'm going to have to find an extra one from somewhere during the last part of the song. Has anyone got a name that hasn't been done yet? Adam. Adam, what else? Adam, Bridget. Okay. Bridget sounded keener than Adam. I feel if I don't do Bridget, I might be harmed before I get out the door. So Adam didn't seem so bothered about it. So Thirteen more ways to leave your lover. Don't be a knob, Rob. Don't be a fool, Paul. Don't be a dick, Rick. Get yourself free. Find a new spark, Mark. Find a new den, Len. Maybe try men, Ken. Get yourself free. Find a new pal, Cal. Find a new lodger, Roger. So little time left, Jeff. Get yourself free. Don't misbehave, Dave. It's time that you leave, Steve. Not rocket science, is it, Bridget? Is anyone still keeping count? Don't be a Madam Adam. Get yourself free. Thank you. Thanks. This is a great gig for me because I just every time I look over there, and if I can't see anything out there. If I look over there, and if I don't see anything, I just do another song. I've also realised that as long as I'm up here, I'll be Oxford FameLab champion. So I'm going to do my 12-minute jazz folk odyssey next. That's the first part of the suite, anyway. What should we do next? I've done some really strange gigs over the last year or so. I've done schools, museums. I did a pie shop. That was my personal favourite. I've done an awful lot of science comedy. So make a big whoop if you've been to a science comedy night before. Make a kind of nervous mumble if you've been to a science comedy night, but that means you're an introvert, so you don't really like whooping upon demand. Science comedy nights are great. For me, they're brilliant anyway, because it's kind of like a regular comedy night for anyone who hasn't been. But the bar for what's acceptably funny is just set much, much lower. So it's wonderful for me, really. But because of that, other strange things happen. When you get this many geeks in a room, small room at the same time, odd things will happen. I did a show once, and the whole way through the show, there was a girl in like the second row, just there, the whole way through the show, like this, and the hands, I mean, it looked like she was doing a text, the whole way, just eyes focused on this, the whole way through the gig, and no one pulled her up on it through the whole night. The thing you'll find about people who do science comedy, not meaning to generalise, but they probably have some experience in their life of being picked on. So they're not wonderful at turning the tables and picking on people in the audience, you know. They kind of know how it feels. So I thought, I've got to say something. So I came up with something really, really witty after the whole night of thinking about it. I said, "What do you think you're doing?" And... yeah, I'm a natural behind the mic, you know. And her response was brilliant. She said, "I'm not texting. I'm doing hyperbolic crochet. I've been listening to everything that's going on, and I'm willing to answer any questions." That's pretty good, you know. And I won't lie, I was speechless. And the one thing you mustn't be when you're up here is speechless, isn't it? You have to have something to say. So I'm not proud of what I did. I hold my hands up, I'm not proud of what I did. But what I did was the most common thing to do in a science comedy show, actually, and that's to do a cheap Brian Cox joke. So I said, "Oh, went hyperbolic crochet, amazing." I did say it was a good impression. It was sort of landed somewhere between sort of Frank Spencer, Terry Christian, and Les Dennis doing his impression of Rita off of Coronation Street. Somewhere in there, high culture reference there, evidently. We do this though, don't we? Don't we all do this? Some things become so big and ubiquitous that we kind of poke fun at them without, in a very different way to how we'd react if they were actually here. You know, if Brian Cox were actually in the room, I'd go, "Oh, Brian, I think you're just so good. You're amazing. You've opened a door for all of us, and everyone in science communication loves you. I just think you're great." But you know, when they're not, it's easy to kind of poke fun, isn't it? And we do this with all sorts of things, like, you know, U2, for example, or TED Talks. You know, it's really easy to kind of get, "Oh, TED Talks are so boring now. There's been so many. They're all the time. They're so formulaic." But the minute I get an email asking me to do one, I'll be like, "Yep, straight away, where'd you sign me up?" So I think it's okay, actually, to be a hypocrite, as long as you accept it, as long as you're willing to admit it. That's okay. So that's what this thing's about. Let's give this a go, see if I can remember this. "'Cause I'm a hypocrite, but at least I admit to it. I'm a real working class hero, just a salt of the earth chap. And I never went to Oxbridge, couldn't even find it on the map. But when I find myself trying to impress high class company, I'll apologize for my upbringing unreservedly, 'cause I'm a hypocrite, but at least I admit to it. Yeah, I'm a hypocrite, but at least I admit to it. And when I'm cruising in the fast lane, I think that's my goddamn right. But when I'm snoozing in the slow lane, I curse those pricks with all my might. And I scream at every bike that weaves past lorry, bus and hearse. But when I'm the one who's cycling, I'll do all of that and worse. 'Cause I'm a hypocrite, but at least I admit to it. Yeah, I'm a hypocrite, but at least I admit to it. I've got all the eco light bulbs, shower every other day. But to car share with my colleagues, man, you must think I'm insane. And I never would touch meat since I read Jonathan Safran Foer. But I still eat fish, 'cause slimy things don't have feelings, you know. Hey, I'm a hypocrite, but at least I admit to it. Yeah, I'm a hypocrite, but at least I admit to it. And lately I've noticed myself poking fun at Brian Cox, like it's some great sin to try taking science to the unwashed. Kinda like how I diss Bono like he was Stalin or Pol Pot. But if you two asked me out on tour, I'd blow him on the spot. Hey, I'm a hypocrite, but at least I admit to it. Yeah, I'm a hypocrite, but at least I admit to it. Thank you. How are we doing? Do we have a decision? Great. this is like my dream. This is the opposite of every other gig. Like, no more. Stop. Yeah, wonderful. How did I first get so obsessed with maths then? I probably should do a song that's about maths or numbers in some way, I suppose. Well, it was through Countdown, actually. I'm sure you're all big Countdown fans. You've come to an evening like this, so you'll be aware of it. But I'm such a big fan of Countdown, actually, that it started shaping and warping my psyche as an adult. On my stag do, my mates took me to a gentleman's club, and the lovely hostess asked me what I wanted, and without even thinking, I said 2 big ones and 4 from anywhere else. It's not too bad a line, that, actually, but what happened in reality was all my mates went in and I just went home. I am properly obsessed with Countdown. It's probably the show I've spent more hours of my life cumulative watching than anything else. And when I was a kid, I really did quite passionately want to be part of the Countdown setup, but I've gotten over it, you know, especially... It's International Women's Day today, and I am a feminist, and I believe that there's not enough women in science or entertainment, and that one role they've got pinned down, i.e. my dream job, doing what Carol did or Rachel does now, is taken. So I kind of have come to accept it, but I'll just play you a quick thing to explain how I came to that acceptance, if I may. I always have been quite the fan of Countdown, the same way my sisters were into Greece. If you've ever sat and written out your 53 times table, you'll appreciate the way I feel at least. I once got a target up in the 900s, starting with nothing more than 25. Next to first holding my baby boy, little has brought me so much joy. Next to getting married, it was the best day of my life. So I want to be the numbers girl on Countdown. There's very little in this life I think I'd rather be. I'm not bothered, I'll go screaming it around town. I want to be the numbers girl on Countdown. When the last bell rang around 3:30, I'd tear out of the front school gates post-haste. Unless I got my daily dose of Vardaman and Whiteley, I would go to sleep a frown upon my face. But now Vardaman, she's been replaced with Riley. And yes, I think that's brilliant, obviously. But boys don't need an extra pool to see the joy in numerals. A hunky geek is critical, and that might just be me. So I want to be the numbers girl on Countdown. And with Sandy Tuxvig host, the gender balance wouldn't change. I should probably get my letter in about now, if I'm gonna be the numbers girl on. I've considered doing harm to Rachel Riley. It seems the only option left to take. I've seen that she can sort of dance, so I might just set up a class where number fours can learn to twist and shake. And when she's lost in her own world and pirouetting, Our hidden, hidden trapdoor in the ground. You see, mostly I'm a pacifist, but I might just break both her wrists. So when she tries to ride a six, it looks the wrong way round. Oh, I want to be the numbers girl on Countdown. And if TV's taught me anything, it's don't give up your dream. I'm just kidding, Rachel, please don't send the boys round. You're a role model for girls in math, so be proud. But if you'd only let me do it once, I'll back down. 'Cause I want to be the numbers girl, that would be my entire world. I want to be the numbers girl on Countdown. Thank you very much. If you want to know more about what I do, you can find me online at Kyle D. Evans. The D is very important, not because there are other famous Kyle Evans, it's just because I'm incredibly pretentious. I'm doing a show in Reading next Sunday with the full slides and more maths, because I know that's what you probably were expecting tonight. Seriously, good luck to everyone. FameLab is an amazing thing, and keep coming along and supporting it. And good luck to you all. Good night. Thank you.